Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is education and skills. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, and I call question number one, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it anticipates the impact will be of reported reductions to college budgets in the North East.
Mr Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, despite the UK Government's autumn statement delivering a worst-case scenario for Scotland's finances, we've been able to maintain funding levels in core teaching at Scottish colleges, including the North East. That is indicative of this Government's commitment to investing in our colleges, despite the challenges posed by UK Government austerity.
Liam Kerr.
Well, despite the largest cash terms block grant in devolution history, there's been a real-term slashing of NESCOL's budget next year, alongside the flat cash settlements of previous years, and they now face a funding gap of £2.7 million. Now, Principal Neil Cowie and his team have worked miracles to preserve places and focus on reducing non-staff costs whilst dealing with training opportunities being withdrawn following the scrapping of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. What impact does the Minister think these specific cuts will have on the North East economy, the just transition and our young people's futures?
Minister.
President Officer, well, can I welcome Liam Kerr acknowledging that the cut, and there is a cut delivered by the budget settlement, is nowhere near on a scale that a number of members in here have suggested would be the case. There was a good deal of scaremongering took place, President Officer, and I note Neil Cowie's acknowledgement in the Press and Journal about the honest position that has been arrived at, which was absolutely in line with what I said at the outset, that we would deliver the same level of funding as colleges received in the current year. Well, you know, Mr Kerr may sit there and gesture, but that is a fact, and I'm glad he's acknowledged that the scale of the cut is not on a par with that that was suggested. Now, that said, Presiding Officer, of course this presents challenges for our colleges. I recognise that. But I do say to Mr Kerr that I don't recall him or any other members in this Parliament during the budget process coming forward with a costed proposal to deliver more money for colleges. I seriously don't remember that, Presiding Officer.
Supplementary first, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. Can the Minister provide an update on the work to ensure that colleges can utilise their assets that become available for disposal to enhance local investment?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as the Cabinet Secretary set out at yesterday's Colleges Scotland conference, we're working hard to support our colleges to invest creatively and with greater certainty, and that includes bringing forward changes so that colleges can retain a significant proportion of the proceeds from the sale of an asset, such as a building or some land, and invest that locally to improve facilities, college infrastructure and estates. The sector has indicated to me a preference for a 70-30 split in what can be used to support vital local investment and what should continue to be released for wider strategic sectoral needs, and that's what we will look to deliver for them.
And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I can understand why yesterday the First Minister felt he couldn't face a conference of colleges, because last month this year's funding allocations for colleges revealed the latest cuts, a £12 million reduction to the student support budget. I'm sure the Minister will agree with me that this funding is crucial for colleges and students to succeed. So can I ask the Minister, how does he expect colleges to continue supporting students while cutting this vital funding?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm lost by that question, I have to say, because I'm not aware of any such cut to student funding support that's planned.
Question two, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its approach alongside Borna Gaelic to secure the long-term future of the Gaelic Officer Scheme.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Goldruth.
The Scottish Government recognises the importance of the Gaelic Officers Scheme for the promotion of Gaelic and local projects that benefit from Gaelic communities, Gaelic communities. For this reason, the Scottish Government provided additional funding over three financial years which supported this scheme. And in this exceptionally tight financial climate, the Scottish Government has made available up to £175,000 to ensure immediate support for the Gaelic Officers Scheme. This will maintain the continuity of employment and the good work that is already in place. And as part of this, the Scottish Government has asked Borna Gaelic to review the scheme and provide a plan for its operation in 24-25.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer and welcome intervention in this matter. Clearly, acute financial pressures remain on Scotland's budget, but what can the Government do to maintain other Gaelic initiatives such as Sport Gaelic, which seeks to encourage the use of the language through sporting activities. Has the Cabinet Secretary had any discussions with organisations regarding the long-term sustainability of these initiatives, particularly in light of the forthcoming Scottish Languages Bill?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Member, Presiding Officer, is absolutely correct. Funding decisions taken by governments elsewhere have had a devastating impact on the spending power of this government. And as the Deputy First Minister noted last month, the spring budget failed to deliver the funding Scotland needs for public services, infrastructure and cost of living measures. However, it is within that context that we have protected the Gaelic budget. And indeed, the Scottish Government supports a network of Gaelic organisations, including, of course, Borna Gaelic. For example, Sports Gaelic is currently in receipt of funding from Borna Gaelic. And in addition, of course, the Scottish Government provides funding of £45,000 to Sports Gaelic last year directly. But we will, of course, continue to engage with Gaelic organisations that support young people outside the classroom. And as Mr Allen knows, I look forward to working with him to that end.
Question 3, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to help resolve the industrial dispute by lecturers.
Minister Graham Day.
President Officer, I meet with campus unions on a biannual basis and representatives of the sector in a number of forums regularly. However, while I can have no direct role, and I should have no direct role in these negotiations, I've been clear that I expect college management and unions to work together to reach a settlement that's affordable, fair for workers and minimises disruption for students. I am aware that both sides agreed at formal NJNC meetings in March to continue with informal discussions to seek a resolution to this dispute, and I'm pleased that this ongoing dialogue continues. I would encourage both sides to keep talking as they work to break the impasse.
Katie Clark.
Lecturers have been taking action short of strike action since February. Despite the action being lawful, colleges have been threatening to deduct up to 100% of lecturers' pay, even when they are attending work as normal. Does the Minister agree that this is completely unacceptable?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, my understanding of the situation, well, and I reiterate, we would all want this dispute to be settled. And the heat to be certainly to be taken out of the current situation. My understanding is that all of the colleges took legal advice, which advised them that they were within their rights to consider action of this nature. I understand also that EIS FIWA have acknowledged such in the advice that they've given their members. But let's be honest, where we would find agreement here that we would all rather that this was avoided.
And supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Can I ask the Minister how the Scottish Government is ensuring fair work principles are embedded throughout the further education sector?
Minister.
President Officer, I set out in the letter of guidance issued by the Government to the Funding Council on the 29th of March of this year, implementation of Fair Work First must be the guiding criteria to promote fairer work practices for staff within the college sector. The Government expects the Scottish Funding Council to continue monitoring adherence across the college sector. To further support fair work in the college sector, the Government recently introduced legislation to add trade union nominees to college boards, which I think will improve trade union recognition and confidence in college governance. Now, not every college has yet arrived at that position, and I would encourage them and the trade unions to work actively to achieve that position.
Question 4, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to update its guidance to schools regarding gender affirmation for children in light of the recommendations in the final report of the CAS review.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring the supporting transgender young people in school guidance remains up to date and fit for purpose. As with any significant legal or policy developments, we will consider whether the guidance requires to be updated to reflect upon those.
Stephen Kerr.
Can I express my respect for the journalistic integrity of Marion Scott at the Sunday Post and Dan Sanderson, the Scottish correspondent to the Daily Telegraph? What they've uncovered in recent weeks has been distressing to parents, and it ought to concern all of us. How campaigning groups are using Scotland's schools to push gender ideology on young children. It's unscientific, and the CAS review has shown the harm it can cause. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree that it is time she reviewed the practice of allowing such campaign groups as LGBT Youth Scotland to influence classroom lesson content and school activities? And would she also agree that we must act now to stop such activists pushing their ideology on our children?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think broadly, as Mr Kerr knows, the CAS review was predominantly a review of the gender health service offered by the NHS in England. However, as I intimated in my original response to the member, we are looking at the implications that may have for our guidance at the current time, and we want to ensure, I think, that that guidance is kept up to date. So to that end, I'm more than happy to engage with the member on that and any views he may have to that end.
And supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been 24 years since Section 28 was overhauled and 10 years since same-sex marriage was legalised. And yet the LGBTQ plus community, particularly the young community, are being caught up in an increasingly toxic debate. So to ask the Cabinet Secretary how we are working in education to ensure that LGBTQ plus young people are included and supported in their school communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, as the member has outlined, it's really important that we have a curriculum which is as diverse as the young people who learn in our schools. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm in and out of Scotland schools on a regular basis. We have a really rich curriculum across our country, and that's why, as well, we have made really significant progress in relation to embedding LGBT inclusive education across the curriculum. And that policy, of course, received cross-party support in the previous Parliament.
Question 5, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support the University Scotland 40 Faces campaign.
Minister Graeme Day.
Presiding Officer, I very much welcome and support University Scotland's 40 Faces campaign. I look forward to hearing the views of students and graduates. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, or myself, had planned on attending the official launch event in May, but it's since been postponed. However, one of us will absolutely look to speak at it when it does take place. I'll also be looking in detail at the findings, because the student support offer and our continuing commitment to free tuition is ensuring that more people can access our world-class institutions, whatever their backgrounds. This campaign supports the progress that we've collectively made to ensure that 20% of university entrants come from the most deprived backgrounds by 2030. But there is more working in partnership to be done, and I think the findings of this campaign will contribute to our making the progress that is required.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank the Minister for his response. And indeed, the University Scotland 40 Faces campaign highlights the access stories of students and graduates to Scotland's universities and HEIs from underrepresented groups, such as students from the most deprived 20% of postcodes, those from low participation schools, students with care experience and or estranged from their families. Does the Minister agree with University Scotland and the Commissioner for Fair Access that by transitioning towards using individual level indicators of socioeconomic disadvantage, this further strengthens the widening access agenda beyond SIMD 20 alone?
Minister.
Then, Officer, I do agree. In fact, my officials have been working with institutions in Aberdeen to set up a pilot project to share data on applicants who are eligible for free school meals to help to identify individuals living in socioeconomic disadvantage. And I'm keen to explore all options for measures that could potentially be used to reach people living in deprivation. One potential measure, as I mentioned in the debate a few weeks ago, that's been suggested is the school clothing grant, and my officials are currently exploring if that's feasible. I'm also hosting a roundtable event shortly at which stakeholders will be invited to share any constructive ideas that they have.
A couple of brief supplementaries for Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, widening participation is a fundamental pillar of the 40 Faces campaign, and the University of the West of Scotland is Scotland's leading university in widening access. Last week, the SFC published its indicative allocations, and the UWS will see its funded places cut by a staggering 734. 220 of those will be reallocated to another institution. UWS wrote to you on the 19th of April detailing their concerns that this will limit its ability to continue to lead in widening access. When was this decision taken to reallocate the places from UWS to another institution brought to the attention of the Minister? Will you meet with the Principal and Vice-Chancellor of the University to discuss the unintended consequences of this decision?
Through the Chair, but Minister.
Presiding Officer, I acknowledge the receipt of that letter and I'll respond to it in due course. And I understand that UWS are unhappy about the decision that the SFC have taken, but I do want to offer a little bit of context here. The 220 places that were moved to another institution have gone to an institution that has been over-providing. So essentially, we had places that were not being used are now being deployed to support delivery in another institution. And surely that is a good thing, that we are supporting young people to be educated. The other point to make is that even with this change that's been made, UWS still retains a substantial number of places beyond what it has been delivering on over the last 2 years that it can grow into. And I'll be happy to discuss this further with UWS, but it's important to realise they will still have the scope to make the contribution we would all hope they would make to the widening access agenda.
And briefly, Douglas Lumsden.
Sir, in the last hour, the principals of both Aberdeen Uni and RGU have sent a scathing letter highlighting the huge financial pressures they are under. They say the universities cannot continue to deliver wide-ranging contributions expected of us with the continuing downward trajectory of funding. So does the Minister understand that the financial crisis that they are under will impact programmes like the 40 Faces campaign?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I go back to a point I made earlier in this session. We have a funding envelope that we have to work within. And I reiterate, I do not remember Douglas Lumsden or any other member in here suggesting during the budget process that we do things differently, that we find more money for universities in this instance. There's a lot of hand-wringing, there continues to be a lot of hand-wringing, but no actual action from those benches. And I do have to say gently to Douglas Lumsden, of course funding is an issue for our university, but if you talk to the universities openly and honestly, they will tell you the biggest threat to their future isn't the funding from the Scottish Government. It was described to me as an existential threat, and that is the ongoing migration rhetoric coming from his government in Westminster.
Question 6 is not lodged. Question 7, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what provision it is making to ensure that all school pupils have access to music tuition.
Cabinet Secretary.
This government has transformed music tuition in Scotland by supporting councils to eradicate unfair instrumental music tuition charges across the country. This year we are providing £12 million to local authorities to support the continued delivery of free instrumental music tuition. The most recent instrumental music survey published in December 2023 showing the number of pupils participating in instrumental music tuition at a record high. Local authorities are responsible for ensuring access to music tuition for pupils in schools across Scotland's 32 local authority areas.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary is very well aware of the fact that within some local authorities, including within Mid Scotland and Fife, there have been very significant financial pressures on councils to ensure that they can maintain the no-fee principle when it comes to pupils accessing free instrumental tuition. Obviously, we've had some staff cutbacks and charges being reintroduced for participation in some central music groups and music camps, including those which cater for special needs. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if the Scottish Government would be prepared to examine a public trust model to assist with the funding of music tuition in order to maintain the commitment this Parliament made to pupils in 2021?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the Member for her interest in this matter, and of course she and I served in the previous Parliament on the Education and Skills Committee that made the recommendation to Government, which led to, of course, the scrapping of instrumental music tuition fees. I think worthwhile recounting, Presiding Officer, the progress that has been made since that time. We know, for example, since the pandemic, pupil numbers have rebounded very strongly after a dip during the pandemic. We're around 61,715, the highest on record since the survey began. This represents a 7% increase since last year. The uptake also now tells us that the highest proportion of the school roll participating in the scheme sits at record levels additionally. And as the former principal of the Royal Conservatoire, John Wallace, has observed, the Scottish Government have kept their end of the bargain, providing an extra £12 million to local instrumental music services. The music teachers on the ground are responding with passion and music education is flourishing. Scots should be celebrating the fact that the Scottish Government has abolished fees for music tuition in schools. To the Member's specific point in relation to the public trust model, if the Member would like to write to me, I'd be more than happy to look at that issue in more detail.
Thank you. Supplementary, Michelle Thompson.
And continuing in a matter which is very dear to my heart, I wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary how the recently announced National Centre for Music will engage with education practitioners to support and inspire young people into music careers.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I very much welcome the development of the old Royal High School building into a National Centre for Music, and I can very much see the important role this will play in inspiring young people in the future. I note and welcome the fact that the Royal High School Preservation Trust want the centre to engage teachers as well as community music organisations and professional performers.
Thank you. Question 8, Colin Beattie.
to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what steps are being taken to tackle bullying in schools.
Cabinet Secretary.
Bullying of any kind is unacceptable and must be addressed quickly and efficiently. And to support schools, we continue to fully fund Respect Me, Scotland's anti-bullying service, to build confidence and capacity to address bullying effectively. And we are currently reviewing our national anti-bullying guidance, Respect for All, which is for all adults working with children and young people. The update includes consideration of the definition of bullying, online bullying, recording and monitoring of incidents, and prejudice-based bullying. The updated guidance is expected to be published by the end of the year, and the National Action Plan on Behaviour will publish in the coming weeks.
Colin Beattie.
More children and young people have been identified as having additional support needs. And we also know there's been an eightfold increase since 2007 in the number of ASN children spending all of their time in mainstream primary school classrooms. A lack of tailored support can result in behavioural concerns due to an inability for the mainstream setting to accommodate support needs. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what is being done to ensure children with ASN receive appropriate support in an educational environment that benefits them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I very much recognise that the number of children and young people identified as having an additional support need continues to increase year on year. It's also important to highlight that spending on additional support for learning by local authorities has reached a record high of £926 million in 2022-23. The Government has continued to invest, of course, an additional £15 million per year since 2019-2020 to help local councils respond to the individual needs of their pupils. And we also provide an additional £11 million of funding every year to directly support pupils with complex additional support needs and services to children and families. On behaviour specifically, though, as members will be aware, the National Action Plan is currently being developed through Sagrabis and is due to be published this spring. The Additional Support for Learning Project Board will also consider the actions in relation to additional support for learning, and that will include a consideration of the Education and Skills Committee report, which I understand will publish soon.
A couple of supplementaries first. Rose McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, bullying in Fife schools is an ongoing issue following Fife Council's policy, which says those who attack and abuse other children should not experience negative consequences. The NASUWT has labelled this policy as counterproductive and that there needs to be serious consequences for serious misbehaviour. So does the Scottish Government agree with the teaching unions, and can the Cabinet Secretary outline what more they can do to get a strong message to local authorities to toughen up their anti-bullying policies?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question and her interest, I should say, in this issue. She's raised it with me on a number of occasions in the Chamber. Of course, as I intimated in my response to the previous member, the National Action Plan will publish in the coming weeks. That will set out the parameters for national government, but also for local authorities. And I think worthwhile saying that the teaching unions, including the one cited by the member, have been included in the development of that National Action Plan.
And Willie Rennie.
I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for the constructive discussion that we had with opposition spokespeople. I think she does understand the scale of the problem of bullied children, of bruised teachers, but also of, and this is really important, about disrupted education as well. Does she agree with me that we need a clear message about the power of the classroom teacher and the backup resources that they can expect to manage that behaviour, that distress and that violence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Broadly, I would agree with the points that Mr Rennie has made. We had, as he says, I think a very helpful meeting last week with opposition members to talk about the progress in relation to the National Action Plan. And it is worthwhile saying that teachers have a number of powers at their disposal right now to respond to challenging behaviour. And teachers across Scotland, I know, are really good at managing to diffuse really challenging situations. That's part of the job of being a teacher. However, I recognise the challenge here, as the member knows. I hope to that end that the National Action Plan will help to set out more clarity on that issue.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. Point of order, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
To Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance on a matter relating to the answer to my question this afternoon to the Minister, in which I asked for his response to the £12 million reduction to the student support budget for colleges. On the 28th of March 2024, the Scottish Funding Council published the College Indicative Funding Allocations 24-25. They set the student support budget at £123 million. Previously, in the previous year, that budget had been set at £135 million, thus leaving the £12 million cut. So can I ask the presiding officer for your guidance on how the minister, who said he was unaware of this and couldn't therefore answer the question, could update Parliament on his response to this and indeed answer that question?
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. You will be aware that that is not a point of order or a matter for the Chair. You have got it on the record. The Minister will have heard what you've said and I'm sure will respond accordingly. And with that, I pause business while front benches change and we move to the next item of business.